I hope you guys enjoy this session. So yeah, without wasting much time, we should start. So as written, your alien robotics. So alien robotic deals with robots that can fly. So these are mostly UAVs, which are unmanned aerial vehicles. So over last few decades, UAV have grown exponentially. So it's already a $25 billion industry, and its applications are ranging from like agriculture, photography, inspection, education, and a lot more. So yeah, this is like a hot field right now. Here, I'm proud to say that our institute has contributed a lot to this field. So we have produced great industry
Hello.
products. And hello, yeah.
Yeah, are you changing the slides?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm proud to say that our institute has contributed a lot to this field. So we have produced great industry products and prototypes by successful startups like DroneVision and IdeaFo. So today we have gathered here to tinker and learn and want to contribute to this exciting field of aerial robotics. So yeah, let's get started. Yeah, so the types of unmanned aerial vehicle. Wait, I think, yeah, okay. Yeah, hope you can see this laser, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so types of unmanned aerial vehicles. So there are different types of unmanned aerial vehicles. So main of this is the, so you can see here, this is the MQ-9 Reaper, and this is the fixed wing type UAV. This is the like the high altitude glider. Down here you can see this is the DJI Agrez. It's a multi-rotor. So multi-rotor means it doesn't have a wing, but it has this rotors. Rotors is means motor and the combination of propeller. So this is the DJI Agrez here, and this is something called as VTOL. So VTOL is vertical takeoff and landing. So what's the issue with fixed wing is ki, for takeoff and landing it needs a runway, right? And the issue with the drone is, see here what happens is when your propulsion systems are on, the lift that is produced by this wing, right? So we are using aerodynamics to generate lift, but here it's also aerodynamics, but it's mostly the thrust by the motors. So these are somewhat like inefficient for long range flight. So that's why we have here the combination of fixed wing and the drone, which is a VTOL. So for taking off, it uses these four rotors, and you see, and then in trans it goes into transition phase in which attains some velocity, and then the fixed wing mode is activated. This is the this is Airship by Zeppelin, and this is something called as lighter than air systems, LTA. So in this, what they do is they have they fill the helium gas in it, which is less light, which is lighter than air. So these things float, and then they have the their control surface is mounted here, so the same propeller combination around the sides and then at the back. So yeah, like it is also good option. So moving on, as you can see here, this is the airship made at the AeroITB with the help of Pluto X kit. So today, in this hackathon, you guys will be working with Pluto X, right? So I put it here so to tell you guys that this isn't just I mean the whole Pluto X won't be limited to just the quad rotors. You know, you can do even more cooler things with it. So this is one of the example. So yeah, they basically programmed, they made this LTA airship, and then they programmed it with using Pluto X to control. So you can see these are the rotors here, and then some are mounted at the back, and these are the stabilizing, you know. So yeah, so moving on, different types of multi-rotors. So we have here, in for quadcopters, we have X configuration and plus configuration. an edge configuration, and then here like tricopters, hexacopters, octocopters, and yeah. So here, one thing to note is this: these are the top views. So for you don't know when you like if you have bought the Pluto Expo, then when you look look at it from above, then this is the top view of it. So our Pluto is X configuration, and similarly. So I would like to bring you to your notice that the small thing about edge configuration. So edge configuration is less stable at roll and more stable at pitch. So what does that mean? So as you can see here, the pitch means, okay, so first of all, roll and pitch. So let's say this is the front of our cord, right? The cord is facing this way. So pitching means it's the cord is rotating in this axis. So these two propellers will go down and these two will go up. So this is called as pitching motion, right? In X direction, cord will rotate. And then, yeah, similarly, the roll is, this is a roll axis. And these two propellers will go down and these two motors will come up. So this is the X configuration. So the thing with edge configuration is the as the like when we talk about the pitch axis, so these two like the actual control the thing which provide thrust are near to the axis, so it's more stable. Yeah, and moving on, so we have your coaxial hexacopters and coaxial octocopters. So this one is the coaxial one. So coaxial one are also used because you know the space used by this octocopter is so much. So to minimize it, we can have this configuration which we have one propeller and then other propeller below it. So the only thing is that lift is increased significantly, but the efficiency is somewhat decreased as compared to the V configuration. Because you know the air above the first propeller, like the propeller which is above it and the propeller which is below it, so their airflow are disturbing each other kind of, so it's a bit noisy airflow. So yeah, moving on. So let's talk about quadcopters. So quadcopters have four independently controlled motors with propellers mounted on rigid frame. So what I have here is this is a DJI quad rotor. So this is the frame, this is the airframe of the quad rotor. So and it has the four motors as you can see mounted on it and the propeller. So note the direction of the rotation. So why do you think, why is it so that the first, like the first and third motors are rotating clockwise and the second and fourth are rotating anti-clockwise? It's written here is the answer is conservation of angular momentum. So let me explain it. Let's say if we consider ki what if all the rotors are rotating in clockwise direction. So what will happen then is the moment generated by this first motor is pointing downward, right? So the moment generated by all of them will be pointing downward. So net moment on the quad rotor won't be conserved. So if this is the case, then what will happen is something that you guys should figure out. If the net moment is pointing downwards, then what the whole free body system will do. Like it's a free body system, right? It's in air. So that is something you guys should ponder upon. Yeah, so the main purpose for it that. So what we do is to not let our cord unstable, we do is which change the direction of rotation of these two blocks. So this is our arm. So on an arm, the both of the propeller are same, but on the other arm, we have this opposite, like counter rotating props. So what happens, this, as I said, this is our roll axis, this is our pitch axis. So about any axis, the movements are kind of balanced. So that's why the rotation, and the direction of rotation is like that, in order to conserve the angular momentum. So let me ask you a question ki, how many independent degrees of freedom do you think a quad rotor has? So like you know, any robotic system has 6 degrees of freedom, right? So if it has to translate in 3 directions and it has to rotate in three directions. So independent degree, so by here independent degrees of freedom, I mean ki, like we, if we want our motion in one of the degrees of freedom, then the motion, like it then the motion in other degrees of freedom should not happen. So yeah, something like that. So to answer this question, what we will first look into the roll, pitch and yaw motion of the quadrotor. So again, I'm saying this is the top view, and this is the forward. So forward means the quadrotor is facing this way, right? So for hover configuration, what we have, we will first look about X configuration only, and you can similarly deduce about the plus configuration from this. So for X configuration, for hover, what we have is all propellers are rotating, as I said, counterclockwise and clockwise. So it's perfectly stable. So how will it happen? Let's say the thrust provided by this motor is T. So T, T, T. So T, I mean 4 into T equal to mg. So we'll get thrust equal to mg by 4. So at that particular thrust, our quadrotor will hover. So when we, now we want to pitch up. So pitch up, so in order to pitch up, as I said, this is our pitch axis, right? So in order to pitch up, what we'll do, we can see, to have motion about any axis, what we have to do is we have to generate a torque about that axis. So we can do this by, but okay, so while we pitch up, we also want to keep track of the our movement. So we want our movement still to be controlled, otherwise core will unnecessarily be unstable. So how we can do that? We can do that by, if this is our pitch axis, then we can increase the speed of rotation of these two motors equally. So then the movement increase in clockwise direction will be same as the one increased by and counterclockwise direction here. So in this way, movements will still be balanced, but overall thrust on this side of the axis will be greater than the thrust by this side of the axis. So our quadrotor will pitch up. Similarly, in this way, you can have roll motion. So this is a roll axis. So we decrease the throttle here, speed, speed here, and increase the speed here. So, and what remains is yaw, and this is interesting. So in yaw, what you want to do, you don't want to roll or pitch, and you don't want to change your altitude either, right? So if you are increasing thrust at some motors, then consequently you should decrease it for the other arm. So let's say for this arm we are increasing, the other arm should decrease the thrust so as to balance it out. So therefore what we do is we on one arm we select one arm, and then rotate the both the rotors in anti-clockwise direction, and on this arm we rotate in clockwise direction. So what you will observe is thrust is overall same, but the movement so this counterclockwise have movement in upward direction, right? And these have movement in downward direction. So the net movement in upward direction has increased. So in order to compensate for this increased movement, unbalanced movement, the quadrotor will itself yaw in clockwise direction. So in this way we achieve yaw motion. So the question which I asked earlier, ki, what will happen if all of them are in rotating in same direction, then the quadrotor will yaw. So, but it will yaw uncontrollably. This is the control. So, moving on. Okay, so now we have discussed the rotational motion. So coming to translational motion. So now, like, it might be a bit intuitive. So if we want to go from here to here, so our quadrotor will first pitch up in this direction, and then at middle or somewhere near, it will pitch back, and then it will come to rest. So why do you have to do this in first place? So as I told, see, this is the quadrotor, and all the, like, what we can control in quadrotor is the thrust. So all the thrusts are pointing upwards, right? So, but if we want the motion around this direction, then we should have, we have to generate a component of thrust along that direction. So for that, we pitch. So if we increase the speed of rotation of these two motors, as I said earlier, so then our quadrotor will pitch. So when then our flight controller accordingly increases the thrust, so the so as such that the horizontal, like our thrust will be then pointing in this direction somewhat, right? So there will be a vertical component, there will be a horizontal component. So vertical component will be equal to the weight, and horizontal component will be the one commanding our drone to its desired location. So coming back to our question, which we saw earlier, ki how many independent degrees of freedom do cloud router have? So by looking at this gif, what do you think? Wait, can I see the chat responses here? If anyone is replying. Okay. Guys, what do you think? Like, how many independent degrees of freedom? Okay, ohm says 3. Yeah, roll motion and translation will be coupled. Yeah, Akshat. Akshat is somewhat right. Cool. Okay. Fine. Because translation is rotation. Fine. So most of you must have got it. So I can see like many 3 here, but let me tell you guys, the 3 is not the answer, it's 4. So as you can see, the first of all, what are coupled is the roll motion. So let's say if our x-axis is in this direction, so our cord is now pitching. So pitching and motion in x direction is coupled, and then rolling and motion in y direction is coupled. So like out of the 6 degrees of freedom, two of them are coupled and the other two are coupled, which is roll and x movement in x direction and pitch and movement in y direction. So such that we have the 4 independent degrees of freedom. So yeah. And if you have any doubts, so you can keep asking in the chat box. We have our fellow conveners with us who will address them for you. And Piyush, if like some questions are like, if you feel some questions are should be discussed in overall, then you can ask me here. Okay. Yeah, because I can't see the chat box. Okay, then moving on. So now we'll move on to the what are like, if let's say we have now you know how to control a quadcopter, like you know how its motion and stuff. So now we actually want to build one. So what all things will it require to build a quadcopter? So just a second. Yeah. So first of all, we have is the quadcopter frame. So this is the airframe. Airframe basically connects all the components, and it's usually made of some lightweight materials like carbon fiber, aluminium, or maybe even it's 3D printed. This is the turret frame, you can see, and I will just briefly describe key how. So you know, this is the motor mount. So we have 4 motors, motor mount here. So as you can see in this frame, they have mounted the motors, and then these are the landing gears for it, landing legs. And the middle surface, this portion is for keeping your battery in it, and the above portion is for your flight controller and then other electronics such as onboard computers and sensors. As you can see here, they have put in their flight controller in between. So, and there are, in mechanically, there are some, you know, springs and all attached to this, in this white thing, so as to avoid vibration to the sensors in our flight computer. So yeah, the frame is this, and then going on. So we have the propellers. So let me tell you some interesting thing about propellers. So propellers obviously are attached to motors, and they provide thrust. So basically, the motor rotates them, and then they produce lift aerodynamically. So they basically push the air above to downward. Another fact is, the more number of blade, the more the thrust is. So this is the 2 blade configuration, and if we take the same 3 blade configuration, then this will provide more thrust. But you do notice that it's it's not d linear, like it's not directly proportional. So maybe the increase in thrust in 2 to 3 is, let's say, t. So increase in thrust in 3 to 4 won't be t, it will be slightly lesser. So number of blades, as we increase number of blades, the thrust is increased. But another thing is that efficiency is somewhat decreased. So the reason for is this due to, as I said, the noisier. So let's say two props are rotating, then the air won't be that noisy. But here, noisy by means the airflow, like this propeller will somewhat interfere in the airflow of this propeller. So the efficiency is reduced as we increase the number of blades. And there are also like aerodynamic losses related to it. Another term which I want you guys to know is the pitch of propeller. So so this is the length of propeller. So this is maybe an 8-inch propeller. And the pitch. So pitch is number of inches our propeller moves forward in one 360 degree rotation. So let's say if I rotate it for like the whole 360 degree, then how much air does it pushes backward, or how much, like how far will it go? So this is something called as pitch. So as you can feel it intuitively, that more the pitch will be, then the more this slantness should be of the propeller. So if the more the slantness, then there will be a lot of drag caused by this. So yeah, so when if you increase the pitch, then drag loss also increases. So you have to keep in mind all those things. So anyway, like we barely design our propellers. We usually buy them, so because in market, all of these are like very standard available. They have, those guys have done a lot of CFD and all to design this shape. So we just directly use them. But yeah, there is a field called rotary wing dynamics, and you know, if anyone of you are interested, you can look into it, how they actually go through the design process of particular propellers. Okay, moving on. So what we use in our quad rotor is the BLDC motor. So BLDC means brushless DC motor. So here I have 2-3 points for you. So first of all, what the difference between brushed and the conventional DC motor and brushless DC motor is, yeah, as the word suggests, these don't have brushes. So, and the conventional one have the carbon brushes. So you might have studied in GE, like you have our the armature ring attached to one shaft, and then there you have the carbon rods in order to switch the polarity, right? So so that is the brushed motor, and they are the, they like, it has the carbon brushes. So what problem with is that there are frictional and some heat losses. So apart from that, the brushes of the DC motor also wear out within time, and it's, so that system is kind of inefficient for quad rotors in which the RPM value is so high. So for that, what we use is this brushless DC motor. So here in this GIF, I explained it in like very easy manner, how brushless DC motor. So this is the coil. So what happens is these are the three coils, A, B, C. And in these three coils, what we do is we actuate them. So actuate such that this is the north pole. So when it's near him, so this coil will be south and this will be north. So this and this is one single coil, this and this is another, and this is the C coil. So when we like pass current through it, then this will be north and this will be south. So accordingly, we, as our magnet is here, so this one will be we will polarize it to south. So automatically it will be pushed by pulled by these coils. So in this way, what happens is ki, your coils remain stationary and this whole magnet will rotate, and then we attach our shaft to this permanent magnet system in conventional motor, whereas as opposed to this, a magnet is fixed and the inner coil is rotated, right? Yeah. So now another thing is ki, higher the KV rating. So KV for BLDC motors, you can see this written 1000 KV rating. So KV is something, higher the KV, so higher your motor will spin. So KV is often quoted in RPM per volt. Yeah, so KV is RPM per volt. And yeah, so I mean higher the RPM, so faster your motor will spin. and it has the inverse relation with tor. So in DC, in conventional DC motor also, the more your RPM will be, the lesser your torque will be. So we have to choose our motor accordingly, but yeah, we will be coming to that shortly. But this is the whole working of BLDC motor, and you know, there are no brushes involved in it. It's just simply pulling forces. So this is quite good. Like mechanically, it's very efficient. So now coming to the control part, so what do you think? Like, you have to actuate this voltage, right? So you can see in E coil, B coil, C coil, these are the graphs. You have to like decrease and increase the voltage accordingly, so as to spin our motor. So to control this particular thing, like switching the voltages around it, what we use is the electric speed control. So electronic speed control is the ESC. We call them ESCs as abbreviation, and these are basically used to command this coil, the voltage values. So what happens, so this is the battery pin for it, and these are the three inputs of motor. So as you can see, our BLDC motor also has three inputs. So in this way, ESC at time, this is the signal pin. So this is usually attached to our flight controller. So flight controller gives signal to this ESC, and then ESC in turn rotate our motor accordingly. And these are the small ESC which are used in racing drones. So yeah, okay. This is how basically this BLDC motor is controlled. Now we have our flight controller here. So I must have used this word often. So basically, flight controller is kind of the brain of your whole quad rotor. So let's approach this in this way. Let's say you have your four motors, and if you provide equal current to all of them, then they will produce a certain amount of thrust, right? So let's say to hover, why do we need a flight controller? Why can't we just supply equal current somehow, and then equal thrust will be produced and our quad rotor will hover? But the thing is, this doesn't happen because due to the mechanical and electrical losses in it. So even if I have the two motors and both motors are same rated and they are manufactured by same company and they have the same rating, but still if I supply 2-2 ampere to both of them, the thrust produced will be slightly different. So, and as we have seen earlier, if even the slightest change in the thrust will disturb our quad rotor motion. So what this flight controller do is, flight controller basically has many sensors on board, like IMU, barometer, GPS and all. So all these sensors, it basically takes data from there, and it takes data from the sensor, and then it somehow like have this feedback. So let's say if at first it provides 2 ampere to both of them, and then flight control notice ki, okay, one of my motor is a bit faulty and it's not rotating as it's not giving the optimal thrust value. So what it will do, it will slightly increase the current in the defective motor so as to make our quad stable. So in this way, the flight controller basically commands the ESCs to send the appropriate amount of current so as to actuate our quad rotor and to make it follow the motion we want to follow. So this is a standard very famous flight controller called as Pixoff. We do have, like, we use Pixoff usually at the club, and other tech teams in industry also like heavily use Pixoff. And these are the different pins you can see. So yeah, I mean, we can see about this pin in the later diagram. Yeah, this one. So yeah, we'll come to that. Now we have lastly the radio transmitter and receiver. So we usually, these quad rotors are RC controlled. So these are the switches and these are your control sticks. So, and this is the receiver. So this thing is in your hand and this thing is on the quad rotor, and this receiver is basically connected to your flight controller in order to command what we want our quad rotor to do. So yeah, and obviously battery. So about battery, here are some important things which I feel you guys should know. So this is a typical lipo battery. We usually use a lithium polymer battery in our drones. So this is called as balance lead. It is used for charging the lipo battery. And the two broad wires here are the main lead. So this is usually connected to your PC band. Like this terminal basically supply the current and voltage to your hot water. In flight, we don't use usually this. So for this, we have there are some things written over here. So let's just see what is it. So it's 1500 mAh. So this on every battery, you will find a mAh rating. So this is the capacity of the battery. So it's written 1500 mAh. So what do you mean by 1500 mAh is this battery can supply 1500 milliampere for 1 hour. So it means it can provide 1.5 ampere constantly for an hour. So this is the capacity of this battery. And here it is written 4S. So 4S means 14.8 volts. So S is basically, it's usually denoted, used for the denoting voltages. So 1S means 3.7 volt. So accordingly, 4S will be 14.8 volt. And the battery, any battery's maximum voltage will be S values is 4.2. So 4 into 4.2 is 16.8. So this battery can maximum, we can charge this battery to 16.8 volt, and the minimum is 3.2. So 3.2 into 4. So that much of amount of voltage is the minimum voltage this battery can be operated at. So this is the voltage rating and this is the C rating. So C rating is 1C means this rating, 1500 mAh. So 2C means 3 ampere hour. So in this way, this C rating is the maximum rate at which you can draw current. So if this rated at 1.5 ampere and the range is given 50 to 100, it means you can draw approximately 150 ampere from this motor. So this is the C rating, like maximum amount of current you can draw from your battery. So these specs are quite important. This will help you in the design process. So here we have the overall electrical layout. So this is the PIXOC, and these are the receivers. So receiver is connected to this PPM encoder, which encodes the receiver signals, and then we provide it to a PIXOC. This is the battery, and we have the power model. So power model basically divide our voltage into 5 volt and the voltage required by motor, which is according to our lipo, and then this 5 volt is supplied to our flight control. And we have other thing. This is the telemetry module, this is the GPS, this is the buzzer, this is the switch, and these are our ESCs and motor family. So in this view, you assemble your quad rotor electronics. So there are like a lot of guide available on internet on how to exactly choose these components, like how to choose a battery, and then how to connect all of those. And this is the circuit diagram of PIXOC. There are many other flight controllers, and for PIXOC also detailed documentation is available on their website regarding this. So so now we come to the part where we learn how to design a drone. So let's say when you resort to design something, first of all, you have your mission requirements with you. So what we have here is the sizing. So what we have here is the as mission requirement is payload and flight time, and this is the maneuverability and safety. So how much maneuverability do you want your quad rotor to be? But the important ones are payload and flight time. So while designing your quad rotor, you should have this value. Okay, I have to lift 2 kg of payload, and then I want 15 minutes of flight time. So these two values are there with you initially, and then what you get output from whole this design process is the battery, how much rating should it be, the propeller size, number of rotors, and the thrust provided by the rotor, like the basically the motors, their configuration. So moving on. So how do we approach this basically? So first of all, we have this payload, and this is the mission parameter, as I said. So this is known to us, this is something we decide. Then what other things that contribute to weight is this battery, structure, and propulsion. So before starting design process, I mean, even in aircraft design, you need to have an initial estimate, right? So what people usually do, they plane ratio. So let's say I have the payload ratio. So they have this propulsion ratio, such as payload, like mass of payload divided by mass of propulsion. This ratio, is kind of defined for a particular task. Let's say I want to build a drone for drone delivery. Then maybe for drone delivery, this ratio is known. Known means from, it's known from historical data mostly. Ki payload or propulsion, like how what's the ratio of the weight between them. And similarly, we have the structure ki if I want to weight lift 2 kg payload, then how much is the structure weight. So with these ratios, you can basically have an estimate for this weight. So here we have the historical data, and then battery, structure, and propulsion weight. So once we have our final weight, what we do is, now we go on to deciding our motor and propeller combination. So these are the general application and the thrust to weight ratio, which are usually demanded by those. So for a normal flight, you need a 2 thrust to weight ratio. For drone delivery, you need 3, and then for surveillance, 4, and then obviously aerobatics and racing drone are much more. They usually have higher thrust to weight ratios. So they are typical ratios, but let's see if you want to design a quadrotor for now. So we will take it as 2. So for that, usually the thrust, so how we take it, we go to the motor's data sheet and we see ki at, so motor data sheet is something that I'll show you. So this is the motor, typical motor data sheet. So you will find a propeller, particular propeller given, and the throttle percent. So 40 to 100, there is throttle percent and how much voltage and how much current do your motor work at. So the current which extracted by this motor at 40% throttle is 4.2 ampere. And accordingly with throttle, it increases. See, you can see at 100% extract 13 ampere current. And corresponding, we have RPM, corresponding we have torque, and then the thrust value. So yeah, at this percent throttle, we have this thrust value. So accordingly, you what we aim to choose is, we in this range 50 to 55%, we want our hover to be. So there is a reason behind this. So if we want our hover to be in 50 to 55% range, then our thrust value should be equal to the weight which we estimated, right? So here we basically okay, I will walk you through the process later. So from this we get the important information such as current. So as I showed you there, the motors, there was the current right from 4 ampere to 30, right? So we can take average of this, and we know ki, during the hover and during aggressive manage, there approximately this much amount of current will be drawn from our motor. So from that estimate, we find the ESC. So the maximum current our ESC can handle our motor demand. So that amount, like that particular ESC, we select. And once we have selected ESC from current, now we have other two values, which is weight and thrust. That is the weight of motors, weight of propulsion system. It is finalized from the motors data sheet, and we have the thrust value here. And here thing is the propeller. Propeller length, as I said, key, the motors provide usually a propeller with them. So the propeller length we have. So we will use these two values to like adjusting our frame size and weight. So how frame size is decided is by propeller. So as I told, from this we get the propeller length. So we design our arm length such that our propellers, air like airflow, they should not interfere with each other. So accordingly, optimally our arm length is selected, and then arm loading is selected. See, if these are your motor mounts, so thrust will be acted upon this point. So at maximum thrust, and then let's say if you attach your payload here, so you can do basic structure analysis, analysis and stuff, and then actually see how much strain, how much stress will be there on this particular arm, and then you can choose your arm length accordingly. So once you know your arm loading, so in this way you can have your airframe selected, and you will have a weight estimate for that. So these are this is the standard turret airframe. We do have this at our club, and then I mean, yeah, these are pretty standard ones available in the market. And this is made out of carbon fiber. This is whole frame is of carbon fiber. This is very lightweight material. So So after that you have this battery sizing. So they told me we have the average current and average flight time required. So you can find your battery capacity. So let's say I have told ki this is the 50 to 100 mAh battery, right? And the average current drawn from your motor is 5.2. So this, if 5.2 ampere current is drawn by your motor, then this battery will last approximately 1 hour. So in this way you can calculate. So if current drawn by motor is 10.4, right, then this battery will last half an hour. In this way you can get your endurance, and you can select this mAh rating according to the flight time you want. But what will happen now, after having all these actual weight estimate, your earlier weight estimate will also change, right? So if earlier weight estimate is changed, then the current which motor will draw at that particular weight is also different, right? So from that your flight time will be affected. So yeah, this is the iterative process. So design payload, then we find our motor and propeller combination, accordingly make thrust choices, right? Then from that we have our frame size and strength, then from that we decide our battery, and from that we calculate our flight time. But because of the change in overall weight, again we basically move back to the first step. So this is an overall like iterative process. So what we do now is here is an example. So let's say I have a historical, I have to lift a payload of 120 kg. So I have estimates for battery structure and propulsive weight. Let's say I saw some other cord which usually lift weight in this range. So these are never the exact values, like pardon me for writing the exact value, but these are the ranges of values. So it might be between 200 to 250, right? So but we take the middle value maybe, and then we have this weight estimate, and then we go to the motor's data sheet, we find the current, we find the mAh rating. As I saw in iteration 2, we have got this weight increase out to 940. So we observed ki, okay, structural weight itna hai, ye itna hai. So finally we have this 940 gram. So again we have to like do all the process. So what you can do is either you can like with like better than to do it manually, what you can do is you can use this eCal. So this is the this is the website eCal, and here you can put your all the configurations of components which you have selected. So battery, your battery type, and then your controller what you are using, and then your motor, T motor, the model number, the propeller, all of this you can input in it, and then it will output all the design parameters like how much mAh battery would you require, and then like all the calculations which we have done done by this eCal website. So this is a pretty handy tool while designing a quad rotor, and this is also there for multi rotors. So this is, we have selected a configuration X. Here there are other configuration available, so maybe you can, interested peeps can go look at this. So yeah, this was the overall design process. So once you know the design and you have like all the values of your different like battery values, ESC values, motor values, so and you have, let's say, assembled it. So after assembly, now what? So now what remains is to actually control it and fly it, right? So before that, so all the controlling, the control aspect will be addressed by Herschel after like after 10 minutes. So before that, let me walk you through the kinematics of this, like the mathematics of this the drone moment. So here we have the XYZ position of the center of mass of quad rotor, and then we have roll pitch here. So one thing to note is that we usually work in two frames, which is body frame and then world frame. So cause our thrust, all the thrust values are in the body frame, then we have to transform them into the world frame so as to keep track of the motion of our quad rotor in actual world, like the world frame. So here we have the linear velocities, which is x dot y dot, and the angular velocity. So the full state vector is something like that. So this is this vector is something that your quad flight control will keep track of every time. So this is called a state of your quad rotor, x, y, z, like position, orientation, velocities, and angular velocity. So this is important. And then dynamics. So dynamics basically deals with the like the force acted upon it, and then the forces and torques which are acted upon motor. So here we have the like on quad rotors, and those are the thrust by the motors, and then gravity. So sometimes, yeah, so when your chord rotor is, let's say, tilted, so that whole your dynamic model will be non-linear, right? So there will be sine theta terms and cos theta terms. So we usually linearize those terms. So we take our like pitching to be at small angles. So accordingly, we write sine theta as theta. So I mean, you will learn about this in detail maybe in some other session, because the mathematics is something that will require a separate session to go through all of that. And you can even go through it. There are various resources available. So soon we'll be sharing some online courses and stuff related to aerial robotics, which basically walk you through those courses will walk you through the mathematics of it. And yeah, it's quite interesting. These are the force and moment on chord rotor. So for the force which is generated by this, like the thrust generated by motor, is kf into omega. So omega is the rotation of this particular motor, angular speed, and kf is the motor constant. And similarly, kmi is the moment constant, so moment generated by this motor. And then, as I told you, my, so along pitch axis, your force will be force generated by these two, F1, F2, cross L. So along Y, this will be the moment, and along F. So, and weight will be equal to mg. So these are basic dynamic equations, and this is like to model it, we usually use vectors. So this is the vector form of it. So mr dot like acceleration equal to force plus what this thing is. This thing is the RS rotation matrix. And so as I told you, our thrust are pointing in Z direction in body frame, right? So let's say thrust provided by the motors are F1, F2, F3, F4, then we sum them. But this thing is in body frame. So basically, we use a rotation matrix to transform our forces from body frame to world frame. And then mg is also acting in the world frame, right? In world frame, our g is pointing downwards in minus z direction. So this rotation matrix is used for that. And yeah, more about rotation matrix and all, you can find that. Like, we won't be going deep into the how this exactly came. But what I want to convey here is, like, in this way, in vectorial form, basically we write our dynamics or dynamical equation, and these are basically used to model your flight controller accordingly. So what you can do now is your flight controller can actually model this equation, and then you have your thrust values. So it can vary, actuate these thrust values and get the required R dot. And from R dot, we can actually plan our get our velocities and accordingly position. So in this way, we can command our chord rotor to. In this way, basically, flight controller use this equation to command your chord rotor to go to a particular. So more about this, all of this, like how these equations are exactly used and how to control a chord rotor, like how motors are basically actuated so as to move our chord rotor from, let's say, point A to point B. How does it follow all the trajectories and all? So this will be covered by Herschel. So okay, so it's 10:24. Maybe we can have a 5 minutes break or something. So in 5 minutes, I mean, you guys can stay here, and maybe in 5 minutes we can start. So I have my fellow convener Herschel with me, so he'll be taking on the session after this, and we will like dive into the controls aspect of